Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Bang, 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 oh, the bar is gone. So run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Don't give the farmer his fun. He'll get by without his rabbit pie. So run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. On the farm, every Friday, on the farm, it's rabbit pie day. So every Friday, that ever comes along, we get up early and sing this little song.
Right, there's a sandstone. building called Nationwide. The former post office for Ben Kiely worked for a year or so at the sorting department. And this again is the other end of that hallway. We're in the front of the third house, Omagh. Good to Deckard Church, you get through your right. And now to John Street. And very shortly passing the office of the Ulster newspapers, where Ben's first news was printed, it was an obituary for a schoolmate who died at the age of 15.
You're taking the left now.
He was persuaded by his classmates to write a little obituary. The first thing in print of the Ulster Herald in 1935. Here's George Street Corner. This public house has gone down to redevelopment. There'll be another pub in this place. War is over here, don't worry. Another pub here.
No.
On the corner.
No, that's
where Ben talked about the old veterans of the war who stood outside it and say if they had seen the Taj Mahal, even they hadn't seen it. We're all laid with this corner.
You're going on.
We're in now to the Gallowshill area in Omagh. Very shortly.
See the car with the blinker?
Very shortly. Aye,
turning right after that. And if you could stop halfway
up. 20 years of his young life.
Just as you turn the corner, you'll see a house with a black end of it.
If you look up to your right, if you can, the house of the
house. That end house there, just. No, you turn
the black on it says St. Patrick Street, also repairs near Patrick. And as we turn the corner, there's a green plaque unveiled in the year 2001. And the presence of Ben Francis here, Benedict Kay. A short story writer, journalist, lived in this house 1923.
In the sober latter days, 1939, early days of 1940, I think we're looking to the songwriters written were asked, inspired, requested to keep up the old morale. There's something to whistle, something to march to, something to step your feet to. I got an old tune, mind you, the Siegfried Line lasted a bit longer than I had expected, but damn good song nonetheless. Take it away, mate.
We're gonna hang our washing on the Siegfried Line. Have you any dirty washing water there? We're gonna hang our washing on the Siegfried Line. For the washing day is near. Whether the water may be wet or dry, we will roll the land without care. We're gonna hang our washing on the Siegfried Line, if the Siegfried Line's still there. Mother dear, I'm writing you from somewhere in France, hoping this finds you well. Sergeant says I'm doing round a soldier and a half, so I sing this little song that always makes a laugh. We're gonna hang our washing on the Siegfried Line. Have you any dirty washing, mother dear? We're gonna hang our washing on the Siegfried Line, if the Siegfried Line is here. Whether the weather may be wet or dry, we'll roll along. Still there.
5 when I grew up. Isaac said he wanted to be German. He was then blonde and chubby and not at all pugnacious. Because he stuttered, he pronounced the word German with 3, sometimes with 6 initial consonants. He had heard it by his father's bedside, where, propped most of the day on high pillows, the old fusilier remembered Givenchy and the scene rich in the hearing of his friends, Doherty, the undertaker. Mickey Fish, who sold fish on Fridays from a flat dray and from door to door. Occasionally, the old fusilier read aloud out of one or other of the learned anthropological tomes dealing with the adventures of Tarzan, the ape man. But mostly the talk was about Germans. Isaac, quiet on his crappy stool, liked the sound of the word.
Bella, the loving wife of the fusilier, had received her husband home from the war, we were told, and at last Kate, the loser, by a stomach shot away when, all his superior officers dead, he, the corporal, gallantly led an action to success. Carried the copy, or whatever it was they carried in Flanders, and stopped just short of advancing like the Dublin, gallant Dublins, into the fire of his own artillery. Back home, stomachless in his glass case, he cheated the War Office on the delicate question of expectation of life, collected a fine pension, and lived at ease until the world was good and ready for another war. No crippled veteran left to beg at the town's end was the old fusilier. Secure in his bed in his lattice windowed room in his white cottage that was snug in the middle of a terrace of 7 white cottages, he talked, read about Tarzan, told how fields were won, and on big British Legion days condescended to receive homage from visiting celebrities, including once Lady Haig herself. On the crappy stool, chubby Isaac absorbed the wonder of half-comprehended words, pondered the girth of the undertaker, the lean, loveless face of the fish merchant, who thought that only beauty could tell him the time on a June evening, watched the hands of Moses as they cut a thorn, or measured the monstrousness of an escape pipe, studied the cowboy's eyes that squinted by way of tuppenny paper-covered books back to the Texas panhandle and the old chisel trail. The undertaker, or the pike fisherman, or the fish merchant, or the cowboy would say, "Isaac, what do you want to be when you grow up?" Isaac would say, "I want to be a German. Then the four visitors would laugh. His father, pale on his pillows, would laugh, forgetting Germans, once seen in the sulphurous haze as he charged through shot and shell to become a hero. His father would read the next installment. When Tarzan of the Apes realized that he was in the grip of the great jaws of a crocodile, he did not, as an ordinary man might have done, give up all hope and resign himself to his fate. His body trailed out beside the slimy carcass of his captor, and into the tough armor the ape man attempted to plunge his stone knife as he was borne to the creature's horrid den. Staggering to his feet, the ape man groped about the reeking, oozy den.
In the moonlight, the cowboy walked home, pulling imaginary guns and talking in admonitory terms to Wyatt Earp. "Stand there, Earp. You may be a big man, but I'll cut you down. Do I have to push you into slapping leather? Alone in the moonlight, on the hill that went down to the red and white creamery, the brook, the cowboy's hut, the fields beyond, he pulled and fired 3 times. With satisfaction he listened to the echoes dying away at the town's last fringe of shabby sleeping terraces. Over the tarred iron roofs of Tansey, the carter's stable yard, over the railway engine shed and the turntable, on green and white moonland beyond the Dublin Railway, a mystic white Bronco galloped in circles as noiselessly the cowboy slipped the smoking coat back into the holster. He turned then and went on down to the hill to Tansey, the carters, and supper. Every day he worked carrying bags of meal to clumsy four-wheeled drays and the warehouse of Dale, the grain merchant, nicknamed Attention, who was an amateur astronomer and had telescope installed in a V-hive-shaped structure at the back of a store. Every night after the Fusilier's reading, the cowboy ate a supper of yellow Indian porridge and buttermilk in the huge coppery kitchen where Kanzi the carter was a smiling extrovert Buddha in the middle of 6 stout sisters who had never shown the least inclination towards matrimony.
Every day, cowboy, the tension's back is stiffer and stiffer,
Tansy said.
He sat on a poker,
said the third sister. The sisters were all red-faced and brown-haired. The fourth one cooked the porridge.
I hear you got drunk on wine rums in Devon's Swedish shop in the bridge today,
Tansy joked.
The sergeant had a real bike home for him.
Seriously resenting the imputation, the cowboy, thumbs in the armholes of his patched and darn grey waistcoat, drawled, "The big boss is a fast man on the draw. He never touches hard liquor."
"We heard he can stare the sun in the face up on that spinning beehive of his,"
said the second sister. And Carter said,
"It takes a good man to stare the sun in the face."
On a hook behind the broad oak door, the first sister considerately hung the Stetson that a rope juggler in a travelling circus had once given to the cowboy. "What goes all between a son and himself is his own business," said the cowboy reverently. "There was a cattleman in Wyoming had as big a spyglass, could spot an engine or a stray 10 miles off."
"You and Wyoming,"
gently said the third sister. "The big boss reaches me wad at the door of the bunkhouse. You pay, Michael," he says. "Count it." I counted £1.19.11. "Penny short, boss," says I. "1 penny deducted, Michael, for a box of matches purchased on credit last Tuesday at 11 a.m. "Oh, he misses nothing."
"Your porridge,"
said Tansy the carter.
"And give us another bit of the story."
"Well, the place I was in at the time," said the cowboy, "down deep south, there was a river, alligators, as plentiful as trout from the brook. This day I went for a swim, just the way you'd go for a swim above the salmon lip by the hospital on the Camoon River."
"Showing off and strutting before the nurses,"
said the third sister.
"For shame, cowboy."
"And what should happen when I was out in the deep water but an alligator? Silent lake, he grabs me by the arm. Oh, I could show you the mark still, but couldn't up. He doesn't take the arm off. He needed it, you see, to drag me down."
"In this life you'll always get somebody to drag you down,"
said the second sister.
"I know where,"
said the cow. "Well, not down the town to a pub with the pitchers anyway. Down to his cave. They live in caves in that river."
"No homes to go to,"
said the third sister.
"Was he big?"
asked the carter.
"Would he be the size now of the last pike that Pat Moses Gavigan caught at Black Session?"
"Size? 10 times the size. A mouth that wide, and the grounds of him. Well, where was I? My body beside the slimy carcass of my captor. But I had a knife. A stone knife. Never swam without it. Wouldn't be safe in those parts. And as I was born to the creature's horrid den, I attempted to plunge my knife into the tough armour of the reptile."
"Cowboy,"
through the charter.
Sure lucky man be alive and eating porridge here this blessed night.
Lucky! Quickness. That's what does it. An ordinary man made a devil of all hope and resigned himself to his fate. From the stables came a wild volley of hooves on calvening wood, and then a second volley and a slow thud, 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 and one mad, high, equine scream.
That's savage you bought,
said the fifth sister.
Sure, he'll never count.
He'll count,
said Tansy.
More than the buck porridge, cried away.
That was a time when Isaac desired, as every child, male or female, sometimes does desire, a pony. It was, of course, long before he found his vocation, and in a green lane above the engine shed, the town's unroofed gymnasium, learned to become the best fighter our town ever had. Poise and stance, dynamite right, cunning left, footwork, speed, quick eye, cool head, and iron muscles, the Fusilier's son was a natural champion. And graduating from the Green Lane, he brought belts, cups, medals, honour and glory home with him from every part of the country. We were proud of him.
But in the days of his desire for a pony, there were no blows struck but one. Where would a boy go who wanted a pony, or a stable to house him, but to Tansy's yard, where the great cart horses stamped with the assured gravity of savants, where the tigers, the horse dealers, displayed the shaggy, sullen-eyed animals they brought and drove from the mountains away to the southwest, even from the tinker camps in the province of Connacht. Roosted high on the shaft of an idle grey, Isaac was there the day Tansy bought the wild white horse. And among the brown shaggy brutes, he was Whiteland Tarzan among the ape people of Acute, and until he felt on his quivering flanks the confining shaft, he concealed horror and docility. Then he reared to the perpendicular, assaulted the heavens, came down again, and lashed out backwards, did the rounds of the yard like a derby winner, while old and young, Isaac among them, ran for shelter. With great Tansy swinging from the reins, the horse went round and round and round, until the cart was in firewood, and broken shafts trailed the ground.
Powerful God,
said Tansy to the tigers.
Where'd you get this one?
At Ballad Of
in the county Galway,
they said, as if that explains everything.
Take him back to Ballad Of,
said Tansy.
But no, linger now,
he said.
There's life in him. He'll cart, I'll coax him.
Dreaming at a safe distance, Isaac saw himself coaxing the savage with gently proffered lumps of sugar. And all through the White One's novitiate under Tansy, Isaac was in constant, reverent attendance. But no coaxing, no lump sugar, no whispers or magic hands could reconcile the untamed tinker spirit of Ballad Of Gallowshill to the base servility of the shafts of the grey.
He has good blood in him,
Tansy said.
I'll try him in a trap.
Some of the fragments of the trap, they say, were found 50 yards away on the railway line, and the great white creature stood shivering as if it were human, it would burst into hysterical sobs. For a whole fortnight, with Isaac perched on high walls or drays or snug on the hay in the hay shed, the wooing went on. And it was one evening in the stable that Isaac said, "Get him to me, Mr. Tansy. I'll tame him for you." For one half second, while the carter distracted turned and laughed, the horse lunged and snapped, the razor teeth grazing the back of Tansy's skull and gashing the lobe of his left ear. The blood came out like a spout, and Tamsley died his hand in it. Then, disregarding it, he looked sadly at the animal. With no sign of temper, he went back to the stable, picked up a crowbar from a heap of rusting metal, and with the deliberation of God, struck the animal between the eyes and stunned it. When it woke up an hour later, it went almost of its own accord to the shafts. Isaac's sugar lumps were never needed.
By the fusilier's bedside that evening, the cowboy was sitting straddled on a stool, knees in and feet out, hands wide, showing how he had held the reins and stayed in the saddle when lesser men had bitten the dust of the rodeo ring. Isaac chewed toffee, he said.
Paddy, the carter, broke a brock today. I saw him. He told his story.
Tansy's a brute,
said Dorothy Undertaker.
He'd slay his six sisters before he'd lose 2 pounds sterling.
You'd benefit, said Gavigan. Six coffins.
They're six fine big girls,
said Mickey Fish.
Not a watch between them,
said the fusilier.
Time doesn't count in Tansy's.
The fusilier read.
Screaming with terror, the Marys were dragged from their lofty perches. The beasts, uncontrolled by Tarzan, who had gone in search of Jane, loosed the full fury of their savage natures upon unhappy wretches who fell into their clutches. Sheeta, in the meanwhile, had felt the great fangs sink into but a single jugular.
Afterwards, when the guests had gone, Isaac said that the cowboy Carson had a ranch once on the Rio Grande. He told me he has 70 pinto ponies.
Son,
said the fusilier,
I hate to rob you of your fancy, but better for your father to do it than the hard world and the black stranger. The cowboy Carson was never out of this town, except perhaps to carry Pat Moses Gavigan's bag as far as the pipe water at Black Session. It all comes out of the wee books you see in the paper shop windows. Deadwood Dick and Buffalo Bill and Hit the Turtle Trail with Hash Knife and Sleepy.
But he was a gunslinger, Dad, in Texas.
Guns? He never saw guns,
said the fusilier, musing for a minute and remembering Flanders and the roar of iron monsters. In the dusk, the cowboy walked home, spurs jingling, stiff and stilted from high heels, bow-legged from the saddle, left to right to left, practicing the cross draw and remembering with affection his deceased friend, Buck Duane, the Lone Star Ranger. He was light and elated. There was no pressure of crushing bags of grain on his old bony shoulders. Melodious with beeves, a freight train from the west truckled on towards Belfast. The cowboy made his customary crooked way to the kitchen of Tansy the carter. You broke the brock today, I'm told, he said to Tansy.
I broke the brock, cowboy. The only way my father taught me. If I buy a horse, the cart, you know, cart, or a woman, the cook.
He never bought a woman,
said the third sister, and the six sisters laughed.
Your porridge, cowboy.
Did I ever tell you about the time I was in New Zealand?
You never did,
said Tansy the carter. When the Americans came to our town on their way to meet Hitler, somebody told them about the cowboy, and one of them, meeting him, said that, haven't we encountered you before?
Was it in Tucson?
Said another.
More whiskey?
Said a third.
It was in Tombstone.
Oh, not there, said the cowboy. I guess and calculate. It might have been in Deadwood.
Deadwood it was. I'll be doggone darned. Have a bit there, right, cowboy?
Said the man behind the bar. I was riding shotgun at the time, said the cowboy. Stiff knee, you see. Couldn't mount a brock.
For corroborative purposes, he displayed his stiff knee. They listened with laughter. They weren't cruel. They were, in fact, kind.
because the worst thing he could have done was to tell him he was never there.
By that time, the old fusilier was dead and buried by Doherty, the undertaker. Attention Dale had been succeeded by a nephew who couldn't face the sun and sold the telescope. Mickey Fish was confined to a mental home for chasing young girls to ask him the time of evening. And arthritis prevented Pat Moses Gavigan from fishing for pike or cutting black thorns. And Isaac, the fusilier's son, had realized that he would never be a German. He came like a bird as a paratrooper into Narvik, came out again alive, and possibly helped the three Americans who had listened to the cowboy to storm the French shore. Until he was killed at the Rhine crossing, he remained the best fighter our town ever had.
Said when and drinking and sleeping. There's a clock on each part of your shore. And that was me and that mother and baby.
I was a very early confirmant. And all I have to say about that little encapsulated in a little song that I wrote some years ago, mostly in the elbow bar, waiting for a pint. It's a right person's feet that are singing for me and Violet and good ladies of Gallowshill who I see here tonight. Right, can we get back to the Ballad of Gallowshill? And stately spires and grand houses long forgone. But in the many a sward in the old west ward, one place haunts my memory still. 'Tis my yellow brick home in the honeycomb that's known as Gallowshill. You just turn your feet from Old John Street and you'll find it close to hand. Or you cross the street from the convent gate to the fair my road so grand. There on the crown, at Old Tin Town, beside the foundry mill, five houses stand in rows so grand on the crest of Gallowshill. And I well recall the labour hall, and I see through memory's lens, where we came from school and played the fool around the cattle pens. The shop on the street where our gang used meet with Mick Smith beside his pill, selling single bags and looking single bags and looking bags to the kids from Gallowshill. And we used to roam the fields and groves beyond the railway line. On a summer's day, our games we play on the hockey pitch so fine. And on that sod, we would applaud when Kevin won 3-0. Oh, the sound of our cheers would bust the ears of the folks of Gallowshill. Aye, in every Lent, an Easter tent was each schoolboy's one desire. From our tent sheds and our bedsteads around a crackling fire, we wore our doves and roasted spuds and wore them with a will. Made tea in a pan or an out of tin can in the fields of Gallowshill. I and all the hearts played dice and cards and pitch and toss of Heyman's back. And around the bins come played outs and ins and corners and jack-jack. On a winter's day, to slide or slay down Patrick Street was a thrill, or to climb the bank that used to flank the slopes of Gallowshill. And his wares were cried by Robert McBride when apples were in crop. Footballs were sold on the Kelvin Road in Charlie Fisher's shoemaker's shop. The livestock marked Joe Quickie's cart and the cubs collecting swill. And tobacco was chawed when parsers were shod on the forge in Gallowshill. And when you went away from your home each day, you don't need to lock your door. But the truth was real, there was nothing to steal in those bygone days of yore. So get me a jar in some dark bar till my eyes with tears do fill. And I'll call